What happened?
I did not hit her! I did not! So we've got to get Lexi's help saving Ava, because she's hemorrhaging behind her eyes, so we need her to stand listlessly in the background while we do all the work ourselves. And of course, being Alex, we're turning him into the next Sith apprentice, so we're going to make the dark side decision and be cold to her to convince her. Hey guys, look, I'm holding an invisible coffee! Aren't I a good actor?
Do you want to play the jealous girlfriend, or do you want to save someone's eye?
Look, I want to play the jealous girlfriend, actually. That's pretty much what I've been doing all game.
You're a doctor, and she's a patient.
Fine, I'll save her goddamn eye! Didn't know she meant so much to you.
Dr. Sloan says to start without him, Dr. Chris.
He's too busy fucking an intern.
Suction out the blood, expose the rim, cauterize the bleed.
Feel the burn! Alright, here comes the surgery, another 7 steppers, so that's how you know it's serious business here. We're gonna start by cutting the old suture, but the problem is gonna be suctioning the blood, because, you know, I've had a serious problem draining the blood so far in this Let's Play. But, you know, maybe if this is a hemorrhage, they won't be bleeding so much, even though that is, functionally retarded of me to say. I'm not necessarily saying the game follows sound medical principles. Alright, so far so good. Seems to be going pretty well. Try to get that blood out of her eyelash there. That's not gonna make her wedding pictures with me look any better. I think I might actually succeed here. It's going pretty well, even though my sucker just threw up blood back into her wound, which is probably not sanitary. Come on, there's like 2 specks there. Just get it. Finally. I feel like while I've got her face open like this, I should leave something for the next doctor to find. Like, just put a chocolate bar in there so next time she gets facial reconstructive surgery, the doctor's like, "Oh, Mr. Goodbar, I love Mr. Goodbar. By the way, Dr. Karev, we're suing you for malpractice. That was an egregious error as a doctor." Alright, so we'll stitch her up here. Again, I gotta say, I'm a pretty good stitcher. My sutures look pretty good. Maybe I've got a future in sutures. Alright. I was running a little bit dry on comedy that time. So now that we've finished that life-saving surgery, we get this even more important life choice of choosing to compliment our co-surgeon who did literally nothing, or expressing concern for our patient. Well, let's be a good doctor and express concern for our patient rather than filleting this girl for no reason.
I don't know if we saved the eye.
We were operating on her eye? Oh, shit! I gave her a hysterectomy when you weren't looking.
I gotta go.
Oh, what's the matter? You got patients? I guess so. Well, I mean, clearly he doesn't. He's just gonna wait here. And scene. Surprise, surprise. Chief of surgery. Oh, God. Izzie. You're still looking after this baby?
I'm not your mother.
You're a doctor. You make like $100,000 a year. Just pay out of pocket for a babysitter. You have patients. God damn. And this game, don't even get me started on this game, that we almost always play anytime we have a scene with Lizzie. I can't imagine anybody stupid enough or just like not experienced enough with games that would find it difficult to click in rhythm with this song. Even if you were deaf, it has the video marker so you can easily see.
What do you want from me? I fed you, I burped you, I even changed your diaper, and trust me, I don't go around changing anyone's diapers. The least you can do is tell me what you want.
Why won't this infant reason with me? God!
Ah, of course, I have to be the one to volunteer.
No one cares about your mundane problems. You work in a hospital. The guy in the room right beside you just got diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. The woman across the hall, her husband just died. Get over it. Your problems are meaningless. Oh, maybe the baby's responding to my rants. He was like, that Northernlion guy had some good things to say. Shut up so I can hear him. Alright, so now, this is where things really kind of go off the deep end. But let's start by finally affirming my lifelong dream of slicing Katherine Heigl across the face. Yeah, I will say that's a very satisfying sound when you rip those Polaroids up. What a strange design choice, but anyway.
You want me to talk about my life?
No, no, he does not want you to talk about your life. He wants you to whip out one of them titties and give him a meal. Talk about love or career. Well, no one else in this game is concerned with their career except for Sandra Oh, so you know, I'm not gonna buck the trend. Let's talk about her love life.
Sometimes I wonder if I'll ever really get over Danny.
Oh, hi, Danny.
Just because I talk about him.
Wow, 2 room jokes in 1 act. I didn't think it would be possible if you asked me before.
I'm pretty good at this. So.
The baby's quiet because it died. You know you're supposed to feed it, right?
To have my best friend back, it would never have worked out. Also.
And the scene mercifully fades to black for us, so we don't have to deal with, again, just the banalities of her life. God. That's the one thing the game has done right so far, I think. Oh, everybody's favorite irredeemable bitch.
See the slot labeled Yang? That's where my chart should be. I can't do my job unless you do yours. Where are my charts?
Looking for
Where are your papers? Scrub Boy has my charts? No, you got the wrong TV show. So what do you think she would do on the show? I mean, I'm assuming probably nobody here has watched a lot of it, myself included, but based on her behavior so far in the game, my guess is that she would probably be kind of a bitch and just try to reach for the papers rather than engage this admittedly nice guy in a conversation. Although he could be a serial killer and or paper salesman, based on my impressions so far. Oh, nice grab. You really gave it your all on that one. Alright, let's try again. You know, these mirror puzzles are actually getting a little bit... shouldn't say trickier, because the key is still almost always just to activate every mirror, but they're getting a little bit more abstract anyway.
I don't have time to play games with a bottom-feeding candy striper. I have a job, an important job, one that involves slicing people open, rearranging their organs, and then sewing them back up.
I know you haven't seen me do any of that so far, but I promise, I actually do at some point.
A friend of mine in the mail removed me a favor. Heard you talking about the Davidson Fellowship and figured you might want this.
It's your rejection letter.
I got it.
I'd say something like congrats, but you don't talk to candy stripers.
Sorry, I wasn't listening. Didn't you hear? I got the Davidson Fellowship. I'm not gonna talk to a bottom feeder like you, motherfucker. I'm rich! And I like how in Act 5, every scene is mercifully short for whatever reason. This is also the act where things get a little bit dire. Before the sixth act, where it all gets brought back up, I assume, and everyone gets healthy again. Much like real life. And again, Eddie has become totally listless, so let's check his blood pressure. One of the most frustrating minigames of all time, because if you miss even a single press, then you have to start over at the very beginning. That might be medically sound, I have no idea. I like the idea that you can fail this minigame. Like, god damn it, I didn't check his blood pressure fast enough. Bailey's gonna have my ass for that one. But of course, you can just take care of a baby all day and ignore your patients, and it doesn't matter.
This is quickening. I'm gonna give you a blood transfusion.
It's so weird, you know? I've spent my whole career turning people's lives into a series of numbers.
I'm Flynn from Tron.
I trusted the numbers. But now, for the first time, I'm not so sure.
Yeah, I'm not so sure you're gonna get another acting job after this gig, buddy. So of course, let's give him a blood transfusion, which involves inserting an arm catheter. See how much I'm learning about medical practices right now? If I ever apply to med school, I'm gonna put this on my application. I played one whole episode of Grey's Anatomy on the PC. They'll be like, shit, you're too stupid to come here. That game is awful. Of course, as usual, the hardest game is just turning this valve, because you have to turn it, 900 degrees clockwise before any blood will come out.
I just assumed I'd be alive for a long time because that's what the numbers said. I spent my whole life saying I can do this later, I can do that later. But what if there is no later?
Could it be any more heavy-handed? Yes, I know what you mean. That wasn't subtle in the least. Grey's Anatomy writers, who are you writing for? Your target audience is not 11-year-old children. Maybe people with the intelligence of 11-year-old children, but, you know, I digress. Apologies to any Grey's Anatomy fans watching, because I'm sure there's probably, you know, all of one of you. Maybe. So we're gonna be courageous here.
Yeah. I know what you mean.
Real courageous, Doctor. You really hooked him up there. And scene complete. Maybe the guy would get a little bit better if we actually treated him beyond checking his blood pressure and then leaving to try to get our dick wet.
You're gonna wait here until she wakes up?
No, I'm gonna leave just before she wakes up. What do you think? Alright, so we gotta cut Alex across the face here. We're gonna stick around at the end of the bed. Again, as a doctor, we have nothing better to do than just wait for one of our patients to wake up. Couldn't get a nurse to look after it, or an orderly just to wait until she wakes up and then tell us. Not just a doctor, we're a surgeon.
Stupid things to her, right before she passed out.
I said I'd like the new Radiohead album. Oh, that's convenient.
I'll leave you two alone.
Yeah, go do some doctor stuff.
You should go after her.
Don't worry about her. Let's check your vision.
Oh, God.
You seeing things in focus?
Sharp, clear, and in technicolor.
Oh, so now when he actually says, test your vision, we don't test her vision. We just take her word for it.
But you're in love, and I'm going home before you make an even bigger mess of things.
Wait, you think I love that girl? You better seriously be joking. You should see some of the things I say to her. I treat her like absolute dog shit. I'm not in love with her. Baby, I would never do facial reconstructive surgery on her. You're the only one I'd ever do medical work on. Alright, so we'll... No matter which one we rip out, the guy looks like a total dumbass in the picture.
Who are you talking about?
Good acting.
Come on, Alex. You cannot pull off Coy.
Can't really pull off any emotion.
Stop screwing it up and go after her.
You're joking, right?
We're okay.
Alex is in love with her? He's pretty much like thrown her to the wayside the entire act or the entire episode so far. That was an unexpected plot twist. Unexpected because there's really nothing. Actually, everything we've seen tells us the exact opposite of what just happened. Alright, so quick neurological exam. How much you want to bet this involves, yep, giving her an eye test. Can't take her word for it, but we can take the person who just had life-threatening facial reconstructive surgery. Yeah, I'm seeing fine. Oh man, the all-important, ever-exciting eye test. My favorite. I wonder, maybe later on in the game someone will actually fail this. I like how the score has gotten really melancholy, because in Act 5, everything gets low before we bring it back up in Act 6. I'm hoping.
I just want to take a quick peek at the wound.
Get the hell off of me!
Sweetheart, please! You have to let the doctor help!
Shut up, Melvin! You're useless! You've always been useless!
Yeah, thanks for taking me in for brain surgery, asshole! You're useless!
I can't believe it. I mean, how could this be possible? Her real personality is the mean one?
Hmm. Oh, I get it. She had that personality-dependent disorder, so every time she had a seizure, her personality changed, but, you know, heavens above, her real personality was the bitchy one. Doctor, can you please put the brain tumor back in her? I'm sorry, Melvin. We'd also have to put back the part that likes Larry the Cable Guy. God damn it! Whoever wins, we lose! So we're clearing away our doubts again, being completely selfless in the face of this man's utter sadness and resignation.
I'm very sorry.
Oh, come on, buck up! Alright, and this is actually like a kind of a difficult light puzzle that you could fail if you weren't paying attention, and, you know, most of you playing this game would probably be asleep right now, so I wouldn't blame you.
You know, Mr. Bellamy, people would understand if you weren't able to do this. What I mean is, there are many places I can refer you to that could help take care of your wife.
She's talking about a hitman.
Never. No matter how her personality changes, she'll always be my wife.
No matter how much of a huge bitch she gets, there is no such thing as divorce in my religion, so I'm stuck with her.
Nothing that can stop you from wanting to be with them.
Oh, please don't tell me this is the transformative moment where she realizes she really loves McDreamy. This guy has a real fucking problem. Not everything is about you, you selfish piece of shit. Thanks for watching, guys. See you next time.